As a Seattle-based criminal defense attorney who's handled a lot of domestic violence-related matters and has a firm that handles these kinds of cases, I want to talk about the mandatory arrest provisions in the state of Washington, how they impact people's lives, or at least as a criminal defense attorney, how I see them impact people's lives. Now, domestic violence is a term of art, and it is really refers to a statutory definition of a relationship. And the legislature has focused on close and personal relationships as areas where they want to be especially careful to separate people because the potential for further violence and the lethality of that situation is very high, according to studies done throughout the state and throughout the nation. And so certain relationships like spousal relationships, anybody related by blood or marriage, children, stepchildren, roommates, all are included within the definition of domestic violence. You'd have to read the statute, or you can look at our website and get more of an idea of what is included in the definition of domestic violence. But I think that gives you a fair idea. In these kinds of relationships, the legislature has decided that if a police officer can determine within the last 4 hours who is a primary aggressor in a fight between these type of people in a relationship, even if it ended up being sort of a mutual combat, if they have any way of determining who they believe is the primary aggressor, in other words, the person who either, I guess, started it or wouldn't stop it. It's an interesting term, primary aggressor, isn't it? They have to arrest. And that determination is not bound by injuries. It's not bound by what's visible injuries. It's not bound by any real concrete evidence. It's in some ways left quite a bit up to the judgment of the police officers. There's an often overlooked fact, however, that the police officers were found liable in a piece of case law that happened in 1992, Roy v. Everett, where their decision not to make an arrest and take action resulted in there being liability. And so there is, from my perspective as a criminal defense attorney, a lot of pressure on police officers to make a decision. Because if they leave two people that have been in a physical fight and they don't make an arrest based on who they believe to be the primary aggressor, and those two people end up in a fight again, or this happens frequently enough, there is a potential exposure for liability. So I find that, in my experience, the police will pick a primary aggressor based off of anything from bias to their opinion to size to sex to who is more dramatic, who is intoxicated. Whether this determination is accurate or not is, as a criminal defense attorney, suspect. But that's my experience with what happens with primary aggressor language, or the implementation of primary aggressor language practically in the criminal system. Now, this doesn't mean that the statutory reasons why they said they want an arrest within the last 4 hours if they can figure out a primary aggressor is not a good idea. It's common knowledge that in studies done on the state and federal level that domestic violence relationships, close and personal relationships, rank very high in the lethality index, meaning the potential for damage and for violence and for death is high. So when emotions are at the hottest within that 4 hour window, it might be best to separate people. However, as somebody who deals with a lot of criminal charges, the problem is when a police officer arrests somebody, there's a natural tendency to want to write a police report that supports that arrest. There's a natural tendency of human beings not to want to be wrong. There's a natural tendency, if there is what I like to call love, if there's 10 facts and you only give 7, is that a full explanation of what happened? Is that telling all the truth, all of the relevant facts? And as much as police officers, I think, have the best intentions, most of them, certainly, mistakes happen, and human nature is a factor in these kinds of cases, training aside. So that's how I see the mandatory arrest provisions playing out from a criminal defense attorney's perspective, at least in a limited number of cases where this statute applies. I hope this helps. Thank you.